name is Susie Beck, and I welcome you to the Church of the Holy Comforter. In preparing for this Advent season, Chris asked the Worship Commission to consider the word fermentation. How does this fit into Advent, you may ask? I can appreciate the question, as my initial response to the word fermentation was doubt. But just as the process of fermentation takes time, I took the time to reflect, really ponder what fermentation means, and how it could possibly apply to Advent. Advent is all about waiting and preparing. Fermenting is a process that produces a change. The first week of Advent is a mini apocalypse. This week, Isaiah begs God not to turn from his people, but to remember that he's our Father, the potter, and we, his people, are the work of his hands. Throughout Advent, we prepare to be changed from lumps of clay into vessels for God's love.
The night is far spent. Let us cast off the works of darkness. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Merciful God, who sent your messengers, the prophets, to preach repentance and prepare the way of salvation, give us grace to heed their warnings and forsake our sins, that we may greet with joy the light of Christ, our Redeemer, which comes into our midst, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The candle of the prophets is lit for all who foretold the light which has come into the world. The Almighty God bless us with his light. Christ, bring us to joys of everlasting life and to the fellowship of the citizens above. May the King of Angels bring us all. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to Mark. Jesus said, "But in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. See also, when these things are taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake." The Gospel of the Lord.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of each one of our hearts be always acceptable to our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Emily Dickinson wrote this of hope. She said that hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. Hope. Hope is the energy of what moves a vision to completion. Hope is that which gives us a taste of the joy that is coming. Hope lives in the not yet, but soon, as something is made or created or ferments. When I was a boy, one of my favorite toys was an Erector set. It came in a metal box full of different sizes of nuts and bolts with girders and beams and wheels and even a motor. I endlessly imagined structures and vehicles that I'd be able to create, and I'd sit down and begin to put them together. And I moved from hope to that which became a reality. Hope is that what moves from an idea to something that's real. And so today is the first day of Advent, a day I think that we are invited to reflect on how we make hope, how we wait with hope. How do we make hope? John Sumwalt shared a wonderful story about hope. Herb Milton stepped into the whirlpool at the YMCA where several of his friends were already soaking in the hot, steamy water and conversing as men do about the deep, ultimate existential concerns of humankind. Things like the point spread of the coming Monday night football game or the latest automobile and how the prices were different from American cars to Japanese to German. The conversation flowed from one topic to another. Family matters, how difficult it is to raise kids, high taxes, politics, local gossip, the differences between men and women. Until finally, they got to talking about human nature. And that was when the conversation became kind of heated. One of the guys expressed very loudly, said, "When it comes right down to it," he said, "we are all basically selfish. We take care of number one and to heck with everyone else." And just then, Herb pulled himself up out of the water to cool off and said in a quiet voice, "I don't agree with you, and I'll tell you why." And he went on to tell a story. Said, "I saw something recently that I have not been able to get out of my mind. As you all know, I'm a jogger. Every afternoon when I get off work, I jog to the convenience store on the corner to pick up my daily paper. One day when I went into the store, the man behind the counter who saves the paper for me, Joe, and whom I've known for years, was standing at the window with tears in his eyes, staring out at what looked like the bus stop across the street. Joe turned to me after a bit and he said, 'Herb, do you see that bench over there?' Nodded and he went on, 'Well, there's an old woman who comes there every day around this time. She sits there for about an hour, knitting and waiting. Buses come and buses go, but she never boards one and she never meets anyone who's getting off. She just knits and waits. One day I took a cup of coffee over to her and sat there with her for a while. She told me that her son is in the Navy now. She last saw him 2 years ago when he left town on one of the buses right out there. She went on to tell him that he's married and he has a wife and a baby daughter. She never seen the daughter-in-law," he said, "or seen the grandchild. And they're the only family that the woman has." Joe went on, "It helps to come here and wait. I knit little things for the baby. They are saving money to come home on the bus next Christmas. And I can't wait to see them," she told him. Well, then Herb continued to tell the story at the men at the Y. Said, my friend behind the counter took a deep breath and then he said, "You know, I just looked out there a little while ago, and there they were getting off the bus. You should have seen the look on her face when they fell into her arms and when she laid eyes on her little granddaughter for the first time. It was the nearest thing to pure joy that I ever hoped to see. I'll never forget that as long as I live," Joe told Herb. Well, Herb sat down in the hot water again of the tub, and he paused for a moment before he said to the guys, "So when I went back the next day, Joe was in his usual place behind the counter. And before he could say anything or even hand me my paper, I looked him in the eye and I said to him, 'Joe, you sent her son the money for the bus tickets, didn't you?' Herb said that Joe looked at him with eyes full of love and a smile that was the nearest thing to complete joy that he'd ever seen. And he said, "Yeah, I sent him the money." Herb told the guys. I've never forgot that look for as long as I live. Hope. Sharing hope, waiting with hope. During this Advent, this so very different Advent, when there are signs of ending all around us, the invitation is to hope. Desmond Tutu said that hope is being able to see that there is light despite all the darkness. And as we heard, hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And Paul said, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. May you wait and watch with hope.
In the darkness of our anticipation, let us pray to the Lord, our God, to bring the light into our world, praying, Christ be our light. As the prophets pointed to the coming of your light in the days of old, preserve, protect, and defend your church in all the world today. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons that they may minister in the darkness of our world.
O God, shine your light into our darkness.
Christ be our light.
As Saint Joseph protected your son and led his family out of danger, guide all those in power that they may protect all your people and lead us in justice and peace.
O God, shine your light into our darkness.
Christ be our light.
As the Virgin Mary nurtured your son throughout his life, have compassion on all those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
O God, shine your light into our darkness.
Christ be our light.
As the shepherds witnessed the coming of your light into the world, Be with us all as we witness the events of our lives. We give thanks especially for those celebrating birthdays or anniversaries.
O God, shine your light into our darkness.
Christ be our light.
As the angels sing praises of your light gathered around you in heaven, be with all who have joined their ranks.
O God, shine your light into our darkness.
Christ be our light.
Be our light in the darkness, O Lord, and in your great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this darkness. For the love of your only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
And now, during this season of waiting and expectation, may your hearts and minds be filled with the love of God and the blessing of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Holy people of God, in this season of increasing darkness, let us show God's light to the world. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.